I think we're living through two big global changes. One is geopolitical and the other is technology. The interesting thing is they're happening at once. So you've got the world moving to a much more, well, let's call it, the moment of American unipolarity is over. There are now adversaries, particularly China, that are near peer or even potentially stronger than the US in certain ways. So that's a fundamental geopolitical shift. But at the same time, you're seeing a revolution in artificial intelligence, technology which will change every aspect of our lives, not least defense and military. And I think that will play out over a very short period of time. This could happen in 5 to 10 years. And it's of the scale of the Industrial Revolution, but will play out over a much shorter period of time.
How does the AI component play into Palantir? It's central, clearly, to what you do. How does generative AI and large language models, how are you building them into your products, particularly when it comes to automated defense software and solutions?
So we provide the software layer in which you deploy the models. So the LLMs are held, if you like, in harnesses by our software so that they can be used in secure, auditable and transparent ways. And that means you can get the maximum value from them. The best way of thinking about an LLM is like a unit of cognition. So all of the workflows, all of the daily tasks that involve some element of human cognition, those are what you might be able to replace over time with LLMs. Now, of course, you need to do that in a way that's very secure, that's very transparent, that's very auditable, but that's what we're embarking upon now. So our software is being deployed by a number of allies in the West, broadly defined, to do precisely this. And what you're seeing is an exponential improvement in their productivity and in the efficiency of what they've traditionally done.
So that's here and now. What does that look like then in 5 years' time, given how rapidly AI is innovating? And if scaling continues as we expect, what does defense software look like in 5 years? How agentic will it be? And how do you keep human in the loop?
So I think the question of how you keep humans in the loop is going to be a policy question. Technologically, unfortunately, I think we're moving in a direction where much of the process can be automated. So lots of this could be done by agents. And so the big question that we're all going to have to confront is, where do you insist on having a human in the loop? And I think in the West, we're very clear about the importance of maintaining that. My concern is that adversaries may not be.
What specifically does Palantir put in place to ensure that there aren't disastrous errors in the deployment of this software? What mitigating factors are built in?
Well, you could think of our software as the mitigating factor. So we are the harness in which you run the model so that you can do that transparently, securely, and auditably. And the audit is the key thing. It means you can know and you can go back in time to check when a decision was taken, what did the decision maker know at that moment in time? What was the context in which they made the decision and so forth? And in the end, that's the safeguard. There's a human in the loop taking the decision, but the software captures everything that the human knew at the time. And so, for example, if it's a question of collateral damage, was that something that was available as information to the decision maker at the moment when they took that step?
You've worked very closely, of course, Palantir, in Ukraine for a number of years since that conflict. What has Palantir learned? What has your team learned by operating, working with the Ukrainians, particularly when it comes to the pace of digital transformation on the battlefield?
Ukraine has been the R&D lab for AI in a military context for the last 3 years. It is the absolute bleeding edge of military technology. There is no substitute for a real battlefield. You can build things in the laboratory, you can test them, but you don't know whether they really work until you've seen it on the battlefield. And Ukraine, sadly, is where that is currently happening. I would pay enormous credit to the Ukrainians here. They have been phenomenally innovative. They're ingenious in many ways. Part of that is circumstance, that they have not had all of the equipment and resources that they would have liked, and so they've been forced to innovate. But that has led to an extraordinary acceleration in military technology, where you're seeing major leaps every 6 to 8 weeks, where tactics and procedures have to change because of some fundamental technological discovery or progress. And I think the only historic analogy that I'm aware of is the development of radar during the Second World War, where every bombing raid back and forth across the channel led to some fundamental discovery in radar. You're seeing something similar occur today in artificial intelligence in Ukraine.
You've signed pretty significant contracts with the MOD here in the UK. You're investing here in the UK. How does that position Palantir to grow and lock in future contracts of that size and scale, not just in the UK, but on the continent?
The UK is, we believe, the country outside of the US and China that has the best quality and quantity of the kind of engineering talent that you need to build software like ours. So the UK can be an epicenter of defence, military technology development. It has all of those ingredients. So that's why we're very keen to make a significant investment here. We want to tap that talent in effect. We already have 1,000 people in London, and that is our second largest office globally, but we want to grow that significantly over the next 5 years. And the UK is the premier military power in Europe. It's a key pillar of NATO. I think it has the potential to be a key bridge into the rest of the continent, but also act as that security guarantor for many other countries.